Thank you, Michael, and welcome to worship at Peace Lutheran Church. This is the last weekend of July. Hard to believe we're almost through the summer season, and we continue to meet vicariously through the internet. But we are glad that you are joining us for this service of worship. And it is our hope that you will join us when it comes time for communion, as you will have the elements in your home, and you can share in the words of institution and share in the promise of a God who is with us, who has showed his love for us through the Christ who died for us. As we come together this day, a couple of announcements. First of all, to invite you on Sunday night at 6 p.m. for Dwight Brewer's Christmas in July concert. He'll be playing a lot of the great music of the season, and hopefully in the midst of the heat of the summer, it might do our spirits good. Also, coming up on August 4th, which is a Tuesday at 7 p.m., we are going to have a town hall meeting. Kathy Anderson, who is the leader of our team who is working through the process by which we are transitioning to our next pastoral leader, will be here to share some of what their work has been accomplished, as well as to respond to your questions. So that's August 4th on Facebook, and that will be at 7 p.m. We also want to thank everybody who's participated in our drives to help those who are hungry, whether they're the homeless downtown or through the West Valley Food Pantry. You are all very generous, and we appreciate the support. And we do appreciate the support that you offer to this church. Because of your gifts to our ministry, we are able to pass on those gifts to a variety of ministries around the world, as well as to support the work that we are doing here at Peace. So again, thank you for your generosity. And with that, we just pray that it is indeed a good week ahead for you, but let us begin our worship with song.
I see a generation
Let us pray. Lord God, as we gather this day, we are grateful for your good news. While we are aware that sin is our rebellion against you, forgiveness is the means by which you reconcile us with you. So help us to not only treasure your forgiveness, but allow us to be forgiving in our relationships with one another. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. At this time, we will continue with the reading of God's Word.
The lesson for today is taken from the second book of Corinthians, chapter 4, verses 1 through 18. Therefore, since through God's mercy we have this ministry, we do not lose heart. Rather, we have renounced secret and shameful ways. We do not use deception, nor do we distort the word of God. On the contrary, by setting forth the truth plainly, we commend ourselves to everyone's conscience in the sight of God. And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. The God of this age has blinded the minds of the unbelievers, so that they cannot see the light of the gospel that displays the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For what we preach is not ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who said, "Let the light shine out of the darkness," made his light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of God's glory displayed in the face of Christ. But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. We are hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed, perplexed, but not in despair, persecuted, but not abandoned, struck down, but not destroyed. We always carry around in our body the death of Jesus, so the light of Jesus may be revealed in our body. For we who are alive are always being given over to the death for Jesus' sake, so that his life may be revealed in our mortal body. So then death is at work in us, but life is at work in you. It is written, "I believed, therefore I have spoken." Since we have the same spirit of faith, we also believe and therefore speak, because we know that the one who raised the Lord Jesus from the dead will also raise us with Jesus and present us with you to himself. All this is for your benefit, so that the grace that is reaching more and more people may cause thanksgiving to overflow to the glory of God. Therefore, we do not lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen, since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. Here ends the lesson. The Holy Gospel appointed for this, the eighth Sunday following the festival of Pentecost, is from St. Matthew. We read in Jesus' name. You are the salt of the earth. But if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. This is the Gospel of our Lord.
Thanks be to God. Grace and peace be with us all in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Back in 1982, and I realize for some of you who are watching this, you weren't even born back then, but my wife and I were engaged. And our nation, well, we were going through some hard times. We were going through a period of recession. People were struggling. And I remember that fall, my wife and I attended an ecumenical Thanksgiving Eve service. And the preacher was the pastor of the Presbyterian Church in our community. And he acknowledged, first of all, that people were struggling, that these were tough times. But then he went on to recount the story of those first settlers, the pilgrims who landed at Plymouth Rock. He told about the difficulties they had in leaving England, of traveling across the Atlantic, and when they arrived there at Plymouth Rock, in what is now known as the state of Massachusetts, their troubles did not end. It indeed was a time of struggle for each and every one of the passengers on that ship. And yet, he also affirmed that despite all their trials, they continued to remain faithful. They trusted and believed that God was with them and that God was at work even in their trials. And so he encouraged us. He encouraged us to remain faithful and to trust that God is good and that God continues to work for good. This is the paradox of faith, of which Paul is describing as he speaks to the church in Corinth. You have to understand that Paul was getting some pushback, that people were having some difficulties with what he taught and what he practiced. You see, it was hard for them to believe that a good God, an all-powerful God, would allow them to be in circumstances of suffering. And not only did he teach them that God was good and that even despite their suffering, that this was a means by which they would experience their hope, they also struggled with the idea, the concept that Paul was God's anointed, that Paul was God's appointed, that Paul was ordained by God to deliver this message to them. They struggled with this because it seemed as if Paul was harangued by people on all sides. You see, as we read through the New Testament, it becomes rather clear that Paul did not have a lot of allies. Paul was no friend of the Romans or of the Jews. They saw him as some kind of social disruptor, an agitator, that they, as soon as he came into their towns, riots would follow, and they would find a way to get him out back on the road, journeying to somewhere else. Not only did Paul not have fans amongst the Romans and the Jews, but neither was the church in Jerusalem, the mother church, all that supportive of his ministry. In fact, their support of him seemed rather tepid. It seemed as if they simply tolerated him. And as we talked about last week, even those who were his companions sometimes found themselves at disagreement with him, and they parted and went their separate ways. Paul was, for all intents and purposes, often out on his own. And then there's the church in Corinth. We know something about the church of Corinth as well, from Paul's letters as well as from the book of Acts. And we know that this was a church that was in dispute, that there were disagreements, that they're disagreeing with one another over whether they follow Paul or Apollos or whether they follow Peter himself. And of course, because of all of this, many of them were wondering, why should I follow Paul? Because Paul himself, well, he's just a big failure. Yeah, we can appreciate that. We Lutherans can appreciate that. Because you see, back before 1960, in the 50s, we Lutherans were in our heyday. The church was growing. Our Sunday schools were filled with eager students. The church was spreading across the map of the United States, and all looked right and good in the world. But over the last 60 years, our Lutheran church has been in decline. We have fewer churches. Our churches are smaller. We struggle to find new leaders, new pastors for our churches. Our churches are growing older and grayer. And if you remember Pastor Carl from a few months ago, he told us that if this continues, that we can look at some serious decline in the Lutheran church. Now, the church has responded to this reality in a couple of different ways. One is to adapt and to adopt the ways of more successful churches, to follow the example of those who seem to be attracting a crowd. And in some cases, that seems to have worked, but it always seems to create a little bit of division and divisiveness within the congregation, because it's really not a part of our DNA. The other response is kind of to stick your head in the sand. And the refrain of this group often is that God has called us to be faithful and not successful. Now, I don't know why God hasn't called us to be faithful and successful at the same time, but nonetheless, this seems to be the two responses that we in the Lutheran Church have adopted. Now, as a Lutheran Christian, I want to affirm that moved by the Holy Spirit, that we are a church of the Reformation. And that means that reform is part of our DNA. In fact, as we look through the entirety of the New Testament, what we see over and over again is a renewed and unique understanding of how they experience God in their midst. And that's part of our Lutheran identity as well, that we trust that that Holy Spirit continues to renew our understanding and our experience of God. But sometimes we lose sight of that. You know, there's an old joke in the Lutheran church: how many Lutherans does it take to change a light bulb? And the response is, change? My grandmother gave us that light bulb. Well, that may be a funny joke, but nonetheless, that's not really who we are. Because we as Lutherans are the people who believe that God's light, that God's love, is causing us to reform ourselves and to reform our understandings of the world in which we live all the time. But again, as a Lutheran, I want to affirm that there are some aspects of who we are that we do not want to lose. For instance, this understanding that salvation, justification, is by God's grace alone, that there's nothing that we can do to earn God's love, to make God love us more than he loves us already. But remember, when Luther brought about this reform of the church, he didn't try to offer something new. He literally went back to the foundations of the church. He went back to the scriptures. He went back to the understanding of what the Apostle Paul and our Lord Jesus had to teach both saints then as well as saints today. And so as we look at what Luther did, we understand that Luther saw the church not as some tradition or history. Luther didn't see the church as some institution or even a building where people would gather, but Luther saw the church as the personal encounter between God and his people, and that because of that personal encounter, that he indeed ordained each and every one of us to be one of his priests, to be a messenger of good news. So I agree with Paul. We do not need to lose heart, because God is constantly at work renewing the church. And even in the midst of this pandemic, and I realize that this pandemic has caused grave suffering in our county, across our state, throughout our land, and around this world. But nonetheless, out of this pandemic have been sown the seeds of change. I think that we can all agree that our world was not necessarily heading in the right direction prior to this pandemic, and that perhaps because of this pandemic, we get a chance to pause, we get a chance to hit the reset button, we get a chance to rethink, to reimagine how societies will be structured, how we will live as an international community, and how we will preserve and protect this world that God has given us. And the same is true for the church. I mean, I understand. It would be great to be able to gather together once again in person to celebrate God's presence in our midst. We miss those opportunities to share in fellowship with one another. But again, let's be honest. More and more people were choosing to opt out of that experience prior to the pandemic. And so we have an opportunity, do we not, because of this pandemic, to rethink the church. To rethink the church not just as the place where the saints of God gather, but to be the place, the community, where the saints are sent out for the sake of this world. You know, that's how Luther understood it. You know, Luther literally unchained the gospel. Because that's exactly how they treated the Bible in his time and age. It was chained to the pulpit so that no layperson could get their hands on it. But Luther loosened those chains and allowed you and me to read the scripture for our very own. Now, of course, that means that there are times when we don't understand what we read, and there's sometimes that we are misinformed and misuse the scriptures. But nonetheless, in some ways, what Luther was practicing is what scientists are doing today when they talk about open source knowledge and how we are working towards a cure for this COVID-19 as scientists are working on research and sharing their research with one another. It's not always right. It's not always good. It's not always perfect. But because we are sharing in that experience, our understanding and our knowledge grows because of that. And the same is true with our knowledge of God's Word. Now, we are in the midst of a pandemic, and yet it seems as if this pandemic has forced the church out of our sanctuaries so that we can see our homes and our neighborhoods as a sanctuary, a means by which God's grace is offered for the sake of the world. And because of this pandemic, perhaps unlike any time in our lifetime, we are beginning to understand that in our baptism, in the reception of the Holy Spirit, in the ordination of that moment, that God has called us to be a royal priesthood for the sake of a broken world. And that because we are this royal priesthood, we who once were nothing are now considered to be ambassadors of good news, ambassadors of God's grace, for the sake of our neighbor. Now, there will come a time when we will once again gather in worship and these momentary troubles will be in the past. But nonetheless, I believe that we can learn something from these momentary troubles. I believe that out of this experience, right, that we have learned that the church is not a place where we go. But the church is a spirit that we carry within us, and that the church goes where we go, and that what we say becomes the good news, the gospel, for the sake of the community at large. And yes, like the pilgrims, we know that there are going to be some treasures that we've had to leave behind. And we know that the journey before us is going to be hard and it is going to be harsh. But nonetheless, like the pilgrims, let us keep our faith, keep our eyes focused on our hope before us, and trust in the goodness of God. Will you join me in prayer? Gracious God, we are thankful at all times and all places for the promise of your presence and the power of your love. Yes, we are aware of the trials and the troubles we face today, but we know that you are the God who can transform the evil of this world into the beauty of your grace. So help us Help us to be instruments of good news. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Michael, would you lead us in song?
Please join with me as we make profession of our Easter faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Gathered together as God's people in Jesus Christ, let us pray for God's creation, those in need, and all the church. Hear us, O God, for your mercy is great. Lord, we ask you to guide the leaders of our world. Give them strength to seek your will and to govern in a way that remembers and cares for the poor, the sick, and the lost. Lord, be with those who suffer from oppression and sickness, and remind them of the hope they have in you. Hear us, O God, for your mercy is great. Lord, we ask that you be with the leaders of our nation and state. Help them make wise decisions that save lives and help those who are suffering. Please be with our teachers and students as they make decisions on how best to proceed. Hear us, O God, for your mercy is great. Lord, we ask that you be with the church on earth. Be with our bishops, our pastors and volunteers. As many of us cannot meet in buildings, help us to build a church that has no walls. Hear us, O God, for your mercy is great. Lord, we confess that we have sinned by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We ask for your forgiveness. Hear us, O God, for your mercy is great. Lord, our world is in pain. Your people suffer from disease, from racism, from loneliness, and from fear of the unknown. Grant us peace as we cry out and lament our state. Help us to trust in you, O Lord, and help us to go forward and work for your kingdom with trust and hope. And Lord, we ask that you help us see your transformation and to work into that transformation in the hope that only you can provide, Lord. Hear us, O God, for your mercy is great. Into your hands, gracious God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen.
Again, we wish to simply acknowledge our gratitude for your generosity as we share the gifts that God has given us for the sake of a broken world. So I invite you to join with me in our prayer of thanksgiving. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Awaken in us a bold spirit this day. We are grateful for the many gifts you have placed in our hearts as well as in our hands. As we have received, we gladly share in a spirit of thanksgiving and of praise. May the gifts we offer this day not only bless the world as well as your church, but may we too be blessed in the offering. All this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And indeed, it is Jesus who gathered his disciples in an upper room to share in a meal of thanksgiving, as they remembered the promise that God had made to their ancestors long ago, as he'd led them out of slavery in Egypt towards a promised land. And so on the night in which our Lord Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, and he gave thanks to his Father in heaven. He then broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took a cup of wine, and again he gave thanks. And he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of all your sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Now I invite you to join with me in the prayer that Jesus first taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. And it is our invitation that you would have elements prepared in your home where you too can share in the promise of Christ's presence as he walks with us, as he guides us, as he loves us. Michael, we'd love to hear some music.
My eyes deep in my heart,
And now may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen us, keep us in his life, his love, keep us on a path of peace this day and always. Amen.
Spirit of joy, Spirit of peace, fill our hearts with a renewed sense of your presence. Let us not be timid in our faith, but may we be empowered by the Holy Spirit to be your apostles. As you send us out into a broken and fear-filled world, let the Spirit of love be revealed in all we do. As we give witness to the promised reign of your kingdom. Alleluia. Amen.
And now may the Lord bless us and keep us. May the Lord make his face shine upon us and be gracious to us. May the Lord look upon us with favor and give us peace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. It has been good to be able to share in this time of worship with all of you. We'll conclude our service with song. Indeed, it has been good to be with you. We want to let you know that we love you, but more importantly, God loves you. So go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Have a good week.